So Sami Tamimi, have I got your surname right? Tamimi. Yes. Sami Tamimi is a consultant child and adolescent psychiatrist from Lincolnshire, so he may give us a perspective from over in England. If I could ask, I think in the interests of keeping us to time, if we leave questions to the end of the presentation, and we will make sure that we get a chance to feed all those questions in. Okay, thank you, Sami.
Thank you. I want to take a step back now, and I want to have a look at some of the fundamental orientating ideas that we have that structure the way we think about what our tasks are when we deliver services. And I think these questions that I'm going to mull over are probably more important, at least to my mind, than questions of funding, questions of access, early detection, intervention, staffing. And they're quite fundamental questions about how we conceptualize our work. And for us as mental health professionals, and I'm saying this as a practicing psychiatrist in the National Health Service, I think we need to do a lot of soul searching, because there is a mountain of evidence out there to suggest that the way we work is based on a way of thinking that is fundamentally incorrect. It has no evidence to back it. And the evidence points us towards re-examining these bases. So I'm going to look at some questions around that. Questions about diagnosis. Questions about how we make decisions about treatment. Questions about how we then structure our treatments. And what does the actual empirical evidence tell us about that? So hold on tight. This is the aspiration of a psychiatry that fits into a kind of core scientific model of how we operate. The technical model, if I'm just to use a little shorthand for it, has obviously been extremely successful in the rest of medicine. It has enabled us to improve prognosis, improve recovery rates, understand the pathophysiology behind a whole host of physical disorders. And the vision has always been that psychiatry could be nicely shoehorned into that natural sciences model. That we can develop a way of classifying the problems that present to us that gives us an understanding of what might be going on biologically or psychologically, and therefore lead to us providing treatments that address these particular pathophysiological problems or psychological problems. So this model works a bit like this. It doesn't exclude other aspects. It doesn't exclude the importance of relationships. It doesn't exclude the importance of people's history, people's stories, people's social context. It doesn't exclude issues to do with their cultural backgrounds, their beliefs. But what it does is it renders them as secondary of importance in the task of what you're doing. The primary task for a psychiatrist or a psychologist or other mental health practitioners is a focus on this technical idea that we have to reach an accurate classification and to understand the problems that are being presented to us in order for us to provide a rational treatment for that particular problem. You following me on that? Yeah? Okay. So this is what structures our understanding of how services. It structures our understanding of things like NICE guidelines and all sorts of other
aspects that have become, if you like, institutionalized into the way that we operate. What is the reality as far as this technical model is concerned? That is a question. We have been promised for decades. And if you go back to look at books, these are just a few recent examples, but if you go back to look at books in the 1930s, in the 1950s, in the the 1960s, all were predicting that we will find a pathway through scientific endeavor, through research, to understand what we are classifying as mental health problems and reduce them into systems of classification that will help us understand
underlying causal mechanisms. We have been promised that for years. I remember, actually, as a psychiatry trainee, and this now goes back to in the early, mid-90s, in the mid-90s, speaking to another trainee, and she predicted that there, by the time, in 25 years' time, at that time, so we're just coming up to that 25 years, there will be a test for schizophrenia. We were on the verge of it. Of course, I bet her that there wouldn't be, and if I could locate her again, I think I'm about to win that bet. So we have been promised jam tomorrow. It's always jam tomorrow. Always let's plow in more money into looking at brains and analyzing genes because we're about to discover what the underlying problems are. And nothing is delivered. Now, the most likely reason why nothing is being delivered is that we are using the wrong model, that the paradigm is wrong. A more disturbing thing is happening now for those who are advocates of the technical model. In the rest of medicine, there are now increasing number of voices who are saying, hey, what's going on in psychiatry? You've been promising things for years, but the evidence doesn't stack up. And when people like Peter Gotcha says something like that, you have to sit up and listen. He is like the equivalent of the Alex Ferguson of the medical world. He is a big hitter. He's been involved in leading on international research and meta-analysis projects for many years. He's widely published in the five most famous medical journals, which are very hard to publish in. So having 50 papers in the big five is a massive. He's published on all sorts of things, from mammograms, from cancer outcomes. And he's had a particular interest in recent years looking at psychiatric medications and the evidence about psychiatric medications, and has come to the conclusion that most of the things that we are talking about and the evidence that we have has been so distorted by the drug industry that there has been a huge mis-selling and to what he considers a criminal degree. He considers these drug companies are operating like legal mafias, corrupt. Their main motivation is to make profit, and it doesn't matter what happens. And he's come to a really shocking conclusion for someone who's a psychiatrist. And he's come to the conclusion our citizens would be better off if we removed all the psychiatric drugs from the market, because doctors are unable to handle them. It is inescapable that their availability creates more harm than good. This is not a fly-by-night person. This is one of the most eminent researchers in the field saying this. And psychiatry is feeling this pressure. And there are psychiatrists who are now proposing that we have been going in the wrong direction, and it's a time to rethink our core task, our core understanding of what it is that we do. So these are just a few headlines from some very recent articles arguing that we've had the wrong paradigm, that we need to re-examine our core belief systems. One of them, for example, Arthur Kleinman, has predicted in his editorial in the British Journal of Psychiatry that if academic psychiatry carries on in the same way it's been doing so far, it will become irrelevant within 20 years. Because it's delivering nothing. Nothing of any use to scientific knowledge, nothing of any use to clinical practice. And others now are repositioning, trying to reposition psychiatry and suggesting that we need to be more robust in our engagement with social and contextual issues. And that the future of psychiatry has a lot more to do with looking at a wider connection in our theories and in our approaches to understanding and engaging with the people that we're trying to help. Let me dig a bit deeper now on some of these issues and what the evidence says on some of these conceptual issues. First of all, with regards to causation, we still have no tests, no independent ways of validating any of the diagnoses that we make. So whereas in the rest of medicine, you will collect a group of symptoms, you will take this as an indicator of possible pathophysiological processes that are happening, you then can arrange some independent data to help you figure out what might be going on. So you can arrange a chest x-ray, a blood test, perhaps a brain scan, and all these different... So these are sources of independent data to try and help you figure out the diagnosis, and the diagnosis is then pointing towards some sort of pathophysiological process. We have none of that in psychiatry. Our diagnoses are based on the subjective opinion of the diagnoser. That's it. Okay. We have lots of peculiarities, which I don't have time to go into, where some diagnoses appear to imply an etiological causation. So, for example, post-traumatic stress disorder suggests that trauma of some sort is behind the symptoms. But when you look at trauma and all sorts of different types of trauma, you will find that trauma comes up as much more likely to be associated with any of the diagnostic categories. In fact, a good psychotherapist friend of mine says the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, have you heard of that? The DSM, which is the American system of making diagnoses. It's an American system for categorizing the different mental health diagnoses that we use. She says this DSM is a wonderful book which describes all the different ways people might react to difficult experiences in their life. So she has a very different model of understanding that. And now that we've got genetics as well, and now that we've got to the level of doing molecular genetic studies, which have become cheaper and faster, and we've got pools of thousands of people whose genes are being decoded, looking for different types of abnormalities, looking for different types of bits of gene that are deleted or repeated. What they're finding is that in terms of the molecular genetics, when you take out things like learning difficulties and other known abnormalities, there's only about 2-3% of the genetic loading is being found. And that 2-3% seems to cross diagnostic categories. So the way we're thinking about our categories do not seem to bear much of a relationship with the natural world. So if you're wanting a system of categorization that works in the same way that it works in the rest of medicine, you would need to be able to demonstrate that your system somehow carves nature at its joints, gives you some way of reflecting naturally occurring categories. Does that make sense? Yeah. But there's so many things that make that idea simply invalid when it comes to psychiatric diagnosis. One of them, for example, is the frequency with which people receive a diagnosis and then it keeps changing. So, you know, you might start off with anxiety, you might then end up with a personality disorder, at some point you might even be thought to have a paranoid psychosis, and then you might have You know, diagnoses can often keep changing if you look at people who've been engaged with mental health services for a long time. If you look at research in diagnosis, and where people are approaching this in a formal manner, where they have to consider all the different diagnoses based on different checklists, what you will find is that most people can have more than one diagnosis. Many can have two, three, and even more. This again suggests that our system does not reflect something that's naturally occurring in our world. This is a broken system. It doesn't work. If that is what is meant to do, it doesn't work in that way. And there's another way of illustrating this. Okay. The first, what we end up is a little bit of, like a game of semantics, a bit of tautology. And this is just one way of illustrating the difference between the status of diagnosis in the rest of medicine and the status of diagnosis in psychiatry. So if you were to ask a question, and you can insert any diagnosis into there, if you were to ask the question, what is ADHD? The only answer that you can give, really, is that ADHD is a problem of inattention, hyperactivity, and poor concentration and impulsivity. So you'd have to give a description, yeah? You have to describe symptoms or behaviors in order to define a diagnosis. Let's compare that with this question. What is diabetes? Now, if I was to answer that question as a doctor by just describing symptoms, saying, diabetes, that's thirst, going to the toilet a lot, fatigue, weight loss, I would be at risk of being struck off, and quite rightly, because there are a lot of different conditions that can cause those types of behaviors, those types of symptoms, those types of signs. What I would need to do is I would need to investigate and figure out what might be behind you presenting with those symptoms. So in order to give an accurate definition of diabetes, I'm going to have to refer to some sort of pathophysiological process. So diabetes is due to an abnormal, an abnormal metabolism of your sugars, and usually related to abnormal insulin production. So you have a very different type of definition for that compared to mental health problems. You following me so far? Yeah. I'll illustrate this in a different way. And this shows where we can really start ending up with problems when we start to think, as we seem to do, that a diagnosis provides an explanation. So let me go back to that ADHD example. If somebody was to come to me and say, look, this kid, they can't concentrate, they're hyperactive, they have inattention. Now, if I was to answer that question and they would say to me, why are they doing that? And if I was to answer that question by saying, well, they have ADHD. And if that person, being a logical person, was to ask me, how do you know it's ADHD? My only answer could be, because they can't concentrate, they're hyperactive, they have poor attention. You see what I mean? We're stuck in a tautology. We're stuck in a circular argument. Diagnoses in psychiatry provide descriptions. They cannot provide explanations. When we start thinking that a diagnosis has provided an explanation, you are committing a philosophical error, but the consequences of which are actually quite profound. And let me have a think here with you about what it is that we're actually assessing when we do a diagnosis. I'm going to show you a tape now, which is from a training video. It's from a training video for something that I find quite worrying. It's the idea that you can diagnose somebody as being at risk of psychosis. I think that's a fundamentally flawed idea, and a lot of research has shown now that the predictive ability to do that is very poor. But in the process, I don't know how many people you might diagnosed as being at risk of psychosis and what that might mean for them and their personal identities and so on. So what was happening there is she was going through a checklist. A checklist of symptoms. That's what you do when you assess for diagnosis. Now, he starts to tell his story, and there's a story about him and his father and working at his garage and the other people in the garage and beginning to think they think that the father favors him and he doesn't want to work there. And, you know, he starts to tell a story about what was causing him distress. And she listens attentively and she every now and then asks clarifying, and then it goes back to further symptoms. Because that's what you do when you assess for a diagnosis. It's a checklist of symptoms. It's form, not content. Now, if I was in his shoes, I would be wanting to give the content. I would be wanting to tell my story. The formal process of making a diagnosis is not about listening to the story, it's about checklist of symptoms. That was from the Patrick McGorry group in Australia, a very, to me, very set of dangerous ideas, that there is expertise out there who know how to identify somebody who is at risk of psychosis and potentially invite them to become a patient completely unnecessarily. What about reliability? Reliability refers to the degree to which, if you were to see me, and for me to make a diagnosis as a psychiatrist and then go and see my colleague and to give exactly the same story, how likely are they to make the same diagnosis? Reliability in psychiatry is shockingly poor. Those of you who've had experience of mental health systems will know that you can see one psychiatrist who will have an opinion about what your diagnosis is. You can repeat a very similar story and they will have a different idea about what their diagnosis, your most appropriate diagnosis is. And neither psychiatrist will have any independent way of validating their ideas or their predictions about what their diagnosis is. I mean, this is a table that includes a statistical measure of degrees of agreement from generated from research. As a general rule, the gold standard, what you're trying to aim for in terms of agreement is above 0.8. Anything below that, and the lower it gets, the worse the level of agreement. And if you're getting down to about 0.2, your levels of agreement are really no better than chance. And some of the major diagnoses that we use in the most recent volume of the DSM, which was published last year, things like generalized anxiety disorder, a 0.2 is no better than chance. It's completely arbitrary whether you'd get that diagnosis or not. Major depressive disorder, where's that? That's 0.32. Only just a little bit better than chance. It's, you know, these are the two biggest diagnostic categories. So we have a real problem with reliability. So that's the diagnosis for us now. That's what we're struggling with, psychiatric diagnosis disorder in my profession. So what, I'm going to come on to treatment, but this is the new life cycle, by the way, since the drug industry got their way. Slowly catching on. Okay. What about long-term outcomes? In the rest of medicine, long-term outcomes for all sorts of conditions have been improving. Well, what's been happening in psychiatry? Well, something very weird has been going on. According to some authors and researchers who've looked at outcome data over the past 100 years, I know it's hard to compare because we have different sources of information, so we're often not comparing like we'd like, but there are some sources, some ways of comparing, and we've got better sources of information for the last few decades where we've got more robust data. well, something strange has been going on. While the rest of medicine have been improving the prognosis, the long-term outcomes in psychiatry have been getting worse. And the strange thing is that they are worse in those countries with the most developed mental health services. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean it's the mental health services. That's just an association. It might be, for example, that actually and there's some evidence to support this, the countries with the most developed mental health services are also the countries with the greatest degree of social inequality. And there's a lot of evidence about the impact of social inequality on mental health, that the larger the social inequality, the bigger the impact on adverse mental health outcomes. But what it does mean is that the systems that we have at the moment have not been able to replicate what happens in the rest of medicine, which is improve our long-term outcomes. In fact, there are some really troubling and shocking statistics out there. If you end up with a kind of chronic mental illness diagnosis, you're likely to die 15 to 20 years earlier than the rest of the population. Now, there can be all sorts of reasons for that, but one of the reasons appears to be linked to, and this is just an association, very difficult to prove this, but the side effects of the medications that are taken long-term. When you're on long-term antipsychotics, you're more likely to get diabetes, heart problems, and so on and so forth. So we've got some issues. And the other thing that's very rarely talked about is stigma. It's talked about in a generic way that the task for reducing stigma is around educating the public better about mental illness. It is and it isn't. It's about, because some of the ways of educating the public about mental illness appears to make stigma worse. And there have been countless studies. There was a recent review which included over 30 studies looking at public attitudes towards mental illness. And the significant finding that comes out again and again is that the model of mental illnesses being an illness just like any other illness is the one that's associated with a greater fear of unpredictability and a greater desire for distance from patients. So the medical model idea of mental illness actually makes stigma worse. It is the wrong model. And then there's this whole concept of internal stigma, and there's a lot of people who've been researching that, including a psychiatrist called Richard Warner, who's looked at this question extensively. And it would appear that people who internalize the idea that they have got some sort of long-term mental illness, which requires an expert, which is beyond their control, which is lifelong, in other words, the medical model of mental illness, have much lower self-esteem, are much less likely to end up back in employment, are much less likely to end up in fulfilling relationships, are much more likely to end up in long-term social isolation and so on. The people with interestingly, the best outcomes are people who recognize that they've got a problem, but actually reject the medical model and see themselves as having some control and some ownership over making differences, meaningful differences in their lives. And we might hear an example of that later. So actually, rejection of the medical model is a better way to fight stigma, both external and internal. We have some serious thinking to do. What about public policy impact? I'll mention a few things. Two well-researched public policy campaigns was one in the UK, the Defeat the Depression campaign, which ran through the 90s. All the studies found that it did not improve outcomes, but it increased the rates of prescribing antidepressants. That was its main achievement. And the one that's really been well investigated is a project in Australia that's still running called Beyond Blue, which was about public education about mental illness, and particularly about depression. And that has been well researched in terms of the impact on people's belief system. And a peculiar finding has come out, that if you are categorized as having poor knowledge about depression, which basically in their category system means that you reject the medical model, that seemed to act as a protective factor. Those people who rejected that model had better outcomes than the people who internalized that model. That is quite a finding. The authors, who were an independent group who did the research, said in their conclusion that they concluded that public campaigns of this sort do not have evidence to support them and they should be discontinued. Other things which have very questionable support are things like education campaigns in schools. There was a project not that long ago which published its findings that found that when you go for psychoeducation for depression in schools, using cognitive behavioral type principles actually increased the likelihood of pupils experiencing negative thoughts. So we have to think carefully about what it is that we're educating people in here. So what about treatments? This is the one to me that really is shocking, because we've had evidence for a long time to tell us that matching a treatment model to a diagnosis has virtually no impact on outcomes. Isn't that astonishing? No impact on outcomes. It's a complete waste of time. I'll show you what the evidence does say. This is a rather hallucinogenic sort of summary of one of the meta-analyses, one of the well-known meta-analyses. A meta-analysis includes bringing together the results of, in this case, over 1,000 different studies on outcome following treatment. And this was the broad conclusion of this meta-analysis. Nearly all, so if you look at the small yellow balloon, that represents all the outcome data pictorially. Nearly the biggest impact on outcome is so-called extra-therapeutic factors. It is what people walk into your consulting room, their real-life histories, their social context, level of support, coexisting medical problems. It's the real-life pictures that people walk into. Now, this is not unusual in healthcare. So, for example, outcomes following a hip operation doesn't just depend on the technical abilities of the surgeon and the type of hip replacement they do, but it also depends on what the patient walks in on. What's their cardiovascular condition? What's their weight? How much support do they have at home? Who will help them with the rehabilitation, and so on and so forth? So this is a well-known thing in healthcare in general, but it is really important in mental health, and it's a bit humbling. It should make us, as clinicians, as practitioners, understand that what's going on in people's real lives is a lot more important than what you have to offer. We do have something to offer. And we have ideas, we have things that we can share, we can collaborate on. But I think a bit more humility about what we offer is really needed here. The things that are happening in people's real lives are much more influential. So from within therapy, there are a number of things that can be boiled down into this, that, and the other. Most of them boil down to some degree towards your ability to establish a meaningful therapeutic relationship. It's actually quite simple, you know? And that is far more powerful, far bigger impact on outcomes than diagnosis and deciding what treatment model you want to use. Because real people have different challenges, And what idea might work for one person, if you don't have an understanding of how to work flexibly and think that, well, right, you know, challenging your automatic thoughts seem to work really well with that person, so the next person that comes into the room, that's going to work really well with. Yeah. If you don't have that flexibility and creativity to work with different ideas, different models, you will lose opportunities to create meaningful therapeutic relationships, which is a bit different to just empathy. You know, it's about collaborating to develop models together. And as part of a number of projects that I've been involved with, for a while I went out, was interviewing different people about their experiences of mental health services. And I'll just play you a clip of the typical sorts of things that we were getting. I'll play you two clips. The first clip is from a service user who was diagnosed with schizophrenia but made a full recovery, just talking about what the thing that made a difference. And the second clip is from a family that I used to see, and it's an interview at the end of the last session with the mother, who was talking about what helped her. And her son had a period where, I mean, he'd been on various medications since he was younger for ADHD. He'd then developed psychotic symptoms, and by the time we're doing this final interview, he was ready for discharge. He was at college doing well, et cetera, et cetera. So a couple of interviews. So there was I waiting for her to say, you know, it was your interpretation that day. You know, everything clicked. It was your brilliant capacity to find an intervention and to change this. And the thing that people again and again came back with were primarily relational issues. About being there, about listening, about taking people seriously, about a sense of connection, about an ability to accept things at face value, and so on and so forth. And okay, yep. And what's the evidence about treatment with antipsychotics? And this is another big area. Because for a while, there's been a number of studies that have found that people who actually manage to find their way out of the psychiatric system successfully seem to have a better outcome. We've also known, for example, that when you look at outcomes in the developing world, they are much better than outcomes in the industrialized, more developed world. And most of the people in the developing world don't have access to the medications. Recently, a study was published by a Dutch group who decided to take some of this literature seriously. And they did something quite novel, which is that they randomized people into two groups. Both groups had 18 months of antipsychotic treatment for a first episode psychosis, and then one group had that medication weaned off, and the other group continued on maintenance doses of medication. And they followed them up. And they followed them up for 7 years now. And the 7-year outcome data is very interesting. Because at 3 years, the group that had been weaned off had had more relapses than the group on maintenance. So at 3 years, they appeared to be doing worse on some aspects. By 7 years, this had changed. Both groups had had a similar number of relapses, but the relapses in the weaned off group were very early in their history. But functionally, the group that had been weaned off were doing far better, were much more likely to be in employment, were much more likely to be in relationships, were functioning in their lives much better than the group who had been maintained on antipsychotics. So it seems that there might be a model here for how we might think about where medication might fit. Medication does not provide a cure, but it might help in the early distress and helping people control
and get on top of some of the most distressing symptoms. But long term, it seems to contribute to worse outcomes. This would be a major challenge to the way we currently operate our services. On the studies with children, the results are really quite disturbing. There was a large study that was conducted in America, but they were going to do this study for 2 years, but they had to abandon it after 1 year because only 10% of the original group had remained on their original treatment. Because what was happening was people were stopping their treatments because of the side effects or because it was ineffective. So this is the study with under 19s and first episode of psychosis. Disturbing stuff. So my conclusion is that currently diagnoses do not help us with the science, do not help us with the understanding, and do not appear to contribute towards improving our clinical outcomes. I personally think that we should not be using diagnosis, we should not be using that, and we should try and start reformulating the dominant paradigms that we use in our service delivery. Things like a recovery focus, things like early discharge from treatment, a focus on outcomes, a focus on the relational factors, an understanding of cultural meanings, and particularly an understanding of power dynamics. Power dynamics are ever present in mental health services. And how do we empower people to become genuine collaborators rather than sitting ourselves as the experts and them with the knowledge and patients as the passive recipients? And as much as we try to, in services, move away from that model, it is very hard to do that when you have an expert-led set of ideas. I know you want to ask some questions. I'll just mention a few things that I've been involved in, a set of projects which are focusing on trying to develop some of these. So you can find out about some of, we've got some e-learning, we're developing a database system, blah, blah, blah. And for me, if genuine change is to happen in services, the change must reach the consulting room. It must change something that happens there. We are used to endless changes happening in mental health services. And they are changes in structure, changes in emphasis, a new service here, a new service. But unless they reach the consulting room, that is not change for me. We need to think about how we develop hope, collaboration, how we develop flexibility. And one of the ways that for example, that I've been using in my practice and that we've been developing in our service is the use of session by session, very simple outcome ratings. And so if things aren't improving, you talk. Maybe I'm not the right person. Maybe you would actually be not my fault, not your fault, but we just don't connect. Maybe it would be better for you to work with someone else, and not seeing that as a failure and not giving in to that temptation that if things aren't improving, what you start doing is you start adding treatments, you know? And so which is profoundly disempowering. So instead of just having a psychiatrist, you've now got a psychologist doing therapy, then you've got a CPN doing something else, and then you've got, you know, and before you know it, there's several people involved, and the message that comes back to you is that you have no abilities or no capacities or no knowledge. You know, most of us actually, I believe profoundly in my work these days, is that most people, nearly everyone I see, has the knowledge to solve whatever dilemmas they're facing. It's just that they don't know that they have the knowledge, and part of my role is helping them find their own knowledge so that ownership of the recovery process by the person is really important, I think. And it's amazing, since I've been thinking that, the more I discover people. I collect my own outcome data. So I have been doing that for a while. I've been very pleased to find out that my own outcome data using these models seem to be pretty good. And I know, for example, looking at the outcome data of the other community consultants in our patch, I have the lowest DNA rate, the lowest levels of referral to inpatient, and most of the medication involvement that I have is weaning people off. I will leave it there.
I'm going to claim chair's privilege here because we are near to the time we need to take a break, and with such a large number of us, I think we need to keep to timings. And so as much as possible, I'm going to ask you to hold those questions till we have our panel session. And remember, the post-its are available too, but I am going to ask one question myself, which is just to try and make it explicit. I think it's clear from what you've been saying, Sami, but if you can, in just a couple of minutes, outline for us, please, your approach. What does that mean in terms of early intervention in psychosis services? I would assume that psychosis is a label you might not choose to fully accept, but what does it mean for the services that you think people in that sort of situation need?
I think I've outlined a few ideas. I don't mind the idea of psychosis because it's a generic idea. Actually, there isn't a diagnosis called psychosis, but it's a generic idea. I think I would want to be able to, if I go back, I think I would want to be able to follow some of these principles with people. First, I'd want to be able to listen to their story. I'd want to help them make sense of it. I'd want to find what ways of working might. I use a number of metaphors in trying to develop collaborative working. One of the metaphors I think about is I go fishing. I go fishing for ideas and seeing what sort of things might hook up into people. And I'm particularly interested in what resources, in what already knowledge they have, and in what sort of intervention they're looking for. Some people want more guidance, other people want more a chance to explain things, or want a level of understanding. So I'm kind of always fishing. I don't follow any format in terms of any of the forms that I have in my service. I simply ignore them. I don't fill any risk assessment. I've never filled a risk assessment in my life. There is no evidence that any risk assessments actually improve safety, but it causes a frame of mind that thinks in terms of risk averseness, which I think is actually profoundly anti-therapeutic. So I try and understand things from what might help me towards developing collaborative working. And then I'm testing it out with each session. Because I do a brief rating scale and we collect outcome data, and I would really encourage that idea, you have a regular testing of whether what we're doing together is making a difference. I always keep in mind that whatever changes are happening, I always keep in mind that they're changes that are being developed by the service user themselves. They have to take ownership for those changes because I'm not out there living their real lives. I'm only sharing some ideas, but they have to do the walking. They have to make the changes. So I always have in mind trying to think about what things, even if they're the tiniest changes that they've already made, helping to try and give people and help people acknowledge a sense of achievement and ownership for their own knowledge and their own abilities. And I'm always opening up the potential for creativity. So I don't tend to follow therapeutic models, but I tend to draw on ideas from different therapeutic models based on what happens live in a session. Because real people, one of the problems with manualized approaches is that real people interfere with them because they have their own thoughts. And in a good therapeutic encounter, you're not just going to you know, ignore people's contributions about what's meaningful to them. You want to find different ways of engaging with that. So I have training in lots of different models. They're all interesting, they're all useful, and I just draw ideas depending on what's happening. But one of the things for services is, I think, keeping a database of your outcomes and learning from that, learning from your successes, learning from which bits are working and which bits aren't working.
I'm sure there are lots of ideas and questions around, but I am going to ask you to hold on to them. I think both of you might find yourself approached over the break and over lunch. If I could ask you now to have your break, and we need to try to be starting again by 5 past, please, by 5 past 12. And if you could just give a final thanks to both of our speakers.